Så if I were to put my finger down here,
yeah,
I would burn myself.
Please don't.
Yeah. Jeg befinder mig i Budapest her på Bosch's store campus i Ungarn. Grunden til at gøre det er, at jeg er hernede for at finde ud af, hvad for en størrelse Bosch egentlig er. De fleste tænker måske, at de laver skruemaskiner og køkkenredskaber, men nej. Bosch er en markant større størrelse. De har mere end 430.000 ansatte worldwide, og så er de altså en af verdens førende inden for bilindustrien, når det kommer til teknologi. Derfor skal jeg møde nogle af verdens førende eksperter. Jeg er enormt spændt på at møde dem, jeg er enormt spændt på at lære, og så er jeg sikker på, at vi nok skal blive bombarderet med en masse information. Jeg nok skal prøve at, skal man sige, translate til et sprog, vi kan forstå os herhjemme. Så i stedet for, at jeg står og snakker om det, så lad os gå ind og høre fra eksperterne dem selv. Det er dem, der har styr på det.
Chunker, pleasure to meet you.
Hi Jacob, nice to meet you.
I denne episode møder vi Chunker. Han er en ægte bilentusiast og en senior ekspert i udvikling af elektriske drivlinjer hos Bosch. Han leder et stort innovationsteam med fokus på teknologier til elektriske drivlinjer. Hans arbejde er centreret om at overvinde udfordringerne ved elektriske køretøjer, især omkring batterieffektivitet. Hans teams er fokuseret på at forberede disse systemer og samtidig bevare energien for at maksimere deres potentiale. Educate me. What is going on inside this room and what are you doing with this room?
Yes, yeah, so let's start maybe with the drivetrain a bit.
Yeah.
So we are examining electrical drivetrains
uh-huh.
and the components of those. Here at Bosch, we have a wide variety of electrical drivetrains, from the bicycle even to the trucks. So basically, what we are doing is the e-axle, so electrical axle,
uh-huh.
and it has three major components.
Yeah.
We have the power electronic unit, is generating AC power from DC, and then we have the electric machine, is generating the rotational movement, and then we have the transmission to fine-tune that movement in terms of parameters, so we need lower RPMs and higher torques.
Okay, and one doesn't work without the other, right? They all
exactly.
have to be connected to it.
They have to be connected to move the car.
So is there a difference? So let's say that I'm on an electrical bike and I'm in an electric car. Is it the same concept for both of those?
Yeah, it has some different solutions within, but the theory is basically the same.
Okay.
So we have something like which is controlling the thing, which providing the excitation, like an inverter and so on. Then we have an electric machine, and we have usually a gearbox to fine-tune to the vehicle needs.
Okay.
Yeah, that rotational movement.
Interesting. Okay. And why are we standing in a room that is completely isolated by these fancy axles?
Yeah, so actually, I would like to show it to you. So if we assemble this together,
yeah.
then we somehow should examine those things.
Okay.
So we prepped up a motor testing there.
Okay.
And we can understand that how we are fine-tuning that motor for the let's say better audible noise.
Okay.
So actually those tiny arrows are vectors.
Yeah.
And they are illustrating the sound. And we have different surfaces as you can see. So the circumference, this front plate and so on. And they are radiating differently.
Okay.
And that's what we should understand. Because if we are radiating too much sound, which is, let's say, not really wanted, then we have to fine-tune the structures.
It seems to be an awful lot of work to figure out, you know, how loud the sound is and where is it coming from. So why is that so important to do?
Yeah, it's really important for the end users. So the OEM, exactly.
Yeah.
So the OEMs, the car manufacturers, always having some kind of definition that what they can accept.
Okay.
Because they know all the customers, so the end users, what they would like to hear, what kind of tones, deeper tones, more preferable usually, and so on. So they have clear requirements for that, and we are trying to fine-tune, to develop
okay.
our drivetrain to those needs.
How is this going to affect the future?
So I believe electric mobility will have a huge impact on our environment. And if we are creating cars with electrical drivetrains, probably the air quality in the cities, within the cities, will be much better at the end.
So is there any areas right now in the world where... Obviously, you have the technology at hand already.
Yeah.
Is there any other areas that we may not be utilizing that technology for right now that we could in the future?
I can mention an emerging one. So actually, the commercial vehicle segment started to be electrified more and more. And there, I would expect in the near future, it will be more widespread. Even in those kind of large trucks and so on, it will be more widespread.
Okay, so definitely improvements coming to that part of the area as well.
Definitely.
Okay. There's an even bigger room where we can test out the full vehicle, so why don't we jump over there and have a look at that? Okay, så altså det her rum i sig selv, fantastisk. Jeg vidste intet om det her 10 minutter siden. Nu vil jeg sige, jeg er lidt bedre klædt på til det. Stadig lidt udfordret. Man kan sige, der er mange forskellige komponenter, mange forskellige ting, man lige skal have styr på, men han gør et virkelig, virkelig godt job på for mig og jer, til ligesom at forstå, hvad det her det handler om.
Here is Mate. He's expecting us.
Jacob.
Hey.
Nice to meet you.
Hi, Mate.
Hi.
So, please, could you tell us that how we are examining usually the sounds, how we are identifying the most critical sounds and so on?
Actually, you can see it right there when you're talking on the monitor.
Yeah.
So this is not a regular camera, it's an acoustic camera. It has cameras on it, but that's just something little. What you really have to pay attention is the little holes. It's 56 microphones on it, and there's a beamforming algorithm behind, which locates where the sound is actually coming from, and this is mapped there.
So basically it works as a sound heat map, so you can see exactly where smaller, bigger sounds, everything is basically coming from the car itself.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's it.
So how sensitive is this? So let's try it with the pencil. I don't know.
That's crazy. So the smallest sound it's able to pick up, and even like on the camera, I can see it here. It was following as it was bouncing away.
Yep.
Yeah. How precise is it? Like, again, you said 56 different microphones. How precise exactly is this camera?
It can be down to the centimeter, depending really on the source and how close you get.
So you said you can basically now, if we were to turn on the car, or if the car were to make any sound whatsoever, we would be able to locate exactly where in the car it's making the sound and how
exactly
loud it is, how low it is, et cetera, et cetera.
Exactly. Yeah.
So it's cool if I just jump in, yeah? Okay, Django. Rumors had it that you know your car sounds and your engines quite well. Is that true?
Maybe. I don't really know. So it's usually working, you know, when I'm with friends and so on.
Sure.
Next to the racing track and so on, then I'm pretty good in that.
Let's test it out and see if you're as good as the rumors has it. You know, it's okay.
We'll see.
You can disappoint. I got one for you here.
It's Italian. It's Italian.
You could hear that straight off the bat.
It's Italian. It's a V12.
It's a V12. You heard that instantly.
Because it's so typical. That one is pretty clear.
Okay.
Would this be a V10?
That is true. It is a V10.
Maybe it's a V8.
It is in fact a V8. Are you ready for one more?
Yeah. Sure. I would say it's a V12.
It's a V8.
Oh.
Django, thank you so much for taking your time to show me all this. It was very, very interesting, and to be completely honest, a world I had no idea about. So I feel much smarter now than when I got here. Super, super spændende møde med Django. Man kan virkelig mærke, at han har noget på hjertet. Man kan virkelig mærke, at han er inde i sit stof. Jeg skal være ærlig indrømme, for 10 minutter siden, før jeg mødte ham, der anede jeg intet om det her, men det kommer stille og roligt. Den næste, vi skal snakke med, er lidt mere specifik i måden at arbejde på. Anna, som vi skal snakke med lige om lidt, hendes job er at sørge for, at ting ikke går op i flammer, så at sige. Det er klart, når du arbejder med de her moduler, når du arbejder med teknologi, så er det ekstremt vigtigt, at sikkerheden er i højsædet. Så lad os gå ind og se, om hun er klar til at fortælle os. Hallo, Anna. Jacob.
Anna, nice to meet you.
Pleasure to meet you. Anna, hun har omkring 8 års erfaring som simulationsingeniør og 4 år som ingeniørchef. Specialiseret i udvikling af strømmoduler, det kritiske komponent, der forbinder batteripakken og elmotoren i en inverter. Hendes arbejde spænder over hele produktets livscyklus, fra det første koncept til serieproduktion osv. As I've been researching a little bit, I do know that your job is basically to make sure that nothing catches fire. Your job is to make sure that it's a safe product to use. So why don't you try to describe to me what that encounters?
My responsibility is to develop the so-called power modules.
Yeah.
This is the key part of the inverter.
Yeah.
And we like to call it as the heart.
Yeah.
Of the electric drive chain, because this product is creating the alternating current that is needed for the motor from the DC current that is supplied by the battery.
Okay.
So basically here you have the connections for the battery, so plus minus, and then here you have the...
So a plus minus like we know from a normal battery, basically.
Yeah, exactly. And then inside this black box, the magic happens and this current gets to transformed for the phase current that is needed for the motor. In the electric motors, electric cars, we work with very high currents.
Yeah.
And we have to make sure that we can switch these currents in a way it is safe.
Yeah.
So basically that you are isolated from the high voltage as a passenger, as a normal person. But also the high current creates high heat. So as the high current flows through a cable, it gets hot.
Yeah.
And we have to make sure that it's cooled down. So that's why, for example, you can see on this product, this cooler, these fins are actually directly in contact with water.
Okay.
So this is connected to the car body, actually, and the water cooling system of the car. We need to make sure that everything that's inside, everything that has the high current, high voltage, is separated electrically from this circuit,
yeah,
but also conducted thermally that we can take away the heat. Let's see what's inside. Basically, how we do this alternating current, so how we create it, is by chips. So chips are semiconductors, basically, and they operate as a switch. So basically, they switch the current, like tuck, tuck, tuck. That's the heartbeat of the car.
Okay, I think I understand the concept now, you know, of how it works. But for me as a consumer, for me as a driver, for me as a regular person, why do I need to know? Why do I need this in my life?
I've been at Bosch since like almost 6 years. And even in these 6 years, we evolved a lot.
Okay.
So we started from like creating products for hybrid cars that are like small and in the city.
Yeah.
And then currently I'm also working on projects where we are delivering this product for SUVs or even sport cars.
Okay. And we heard about the semi trucks and the big trucks coming out as well. So I guess you need to be able to work with bigger vehicles and bigger things for the future as well.
So we have to make sure it's as efficient as possible.
So we can go as long as possible.
Exactly, because as a customer, you want to drive as much as possible with your with your battery. And then if it's more efficient, then you lose less battery power during the drive. So
all right, so I'm getting smarter by the minute, and you're about to make me even smarter, because you know you set up this little arrangement to actually showcase what's going on if you don't cool all of this down.
Basically, so we have here a thermal camera, so you will see how hot it gets. Additionally, I also wanted to show you that these chips are now operated as simple diodes, and diode is in the LED, like light emitting diode, so it will emit also some light.
So a nice little demonstration going on here. Spændt på at se hvad det her det går ud på. Klart, hendes job er at sørge for at ting ikke går op i flammer, så går ud fra hun har styr på hvad hun laver, eller så må vi løbe.
Okay, so let me turn it on.
You sure we're safe here?
Yeah. So you can see now that those are the chips that now really like light up blue. And then if you look on the camera picture, you can see here the temperature going up.
Very fast as well, yeah?
Yeah, exactly. So we are at like 60, 70 degrees Celsius right now.
So if I were to put my finger down here, I would
burn
myself.
Please don't.
Yeah.
You see that the main source of heat is the chips.
Okay, so it went up to almost 100 degrees there.
Yeah, and now you can see how it is cooling down.
Is there a point where it just, you know, if it goes above a certain threshold, does it just catch fire or what happens?
So basically some like plastic parts could burn.
Okay.
Or the chips could like destroy themselves.
Okay.
But they are like tolerating way higher temperatures.
Okay, sure. Smart. Okay, we have come a long way. Thank you so, so much, Anna, for inviting me into this world and explaining me how this is all happening. I must admit that my brain is probably not able to comprehend it all, but it does sound like you got it undercover. So thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Tusind tak for at have fulgt med i min lille minirejse hernede i Budapest på Bosch's campus. Som sagt allerede, som I har set, jamen, så er der masser af den her teknologi, vi støder på til dagligt. Så hvorvidt det er jeres telefon, I tager frem, hvorvidt det sætter ind i en bil, jamen, så vil I støde på noget af Bosch's teknologi. Det anede jeg ikke, da jeg kom herned, og jeg anede heller ikke, at de var i gang med at innovere så meget, som de er. Så jeg håber, I har fået lige så meget ud af at følge med her, som jeg har. Det var en fornøjelse at fremvise det for jer, og jeg håber, I har nydt det. Hvis I fandt den her episode interessant, så husk på, at der er to episoder mere, I kan finde på Bosch's YouTube-kanal eller på deres hjemmeside.